This is Duke University.
Thank you. Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ, and welcome to worship this morning. Here at Duke Chapel, we strive to keep the heart of the university listening to the heart of God, and we do hope that you will have an encounter with the living Lord through worship this morning. We're delighted to have Reverend McKennon Shea as our guest preacher. McKennon is no stranger to the chapel. He was the assistant pastor of the congregation before moving across the courtyard to become the director of admissions at the Divinity School. And we're happy to have McKennon with us today. It's August already, and if you feel like you need a little more music in your life, then I would encourage you to join the summer choir while you can. There's one last week. Next Sunday is the last Sunday for the summer choir. All you have to do is show up at 9:15 for rehearsal, and it's a great opportunity to exercise your lungs and your vocal cords and to get to know our new assistant conductor, Brian Schmidt. Please stand as we sing our praises to God.
Thank you. Our souls grope in darkness, but the one light beckons us home. We confess our sins, trusting in the grace and love of God. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. May the God of all healing and forgiveness draw close to you, cleanse you of all of your sins, and strengthen you to live in the power of the Holy Spirit all of your days. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Perfect love casts out fear. Let us celebrate our reconciliation with God in signs and words of reconciliation with each other.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination printed in your bulletin. Gracious Father, revive your church in our day and make her holy, strong, and faithful. And revive us in the reading of your word that we may be the same for your glory's sake. In Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Old Testament lesson is from 2 Samuel, the 11th and 12 chapters. When the wife of Uriah heard that her husband was dead, Bathsheba made lamentation for him. When the mourning was over, David sent and brought her to his house, and she became his wife and bore him a son. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord, and the Lord sent Nathan to David. Nathan came to David and said to him, "There were two men in a certain city, one rich and the other poor. The rich man had very many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing but one little ewe lamb, which he bought. He brought it up, and it grew up with him and his children. It used to eat of his meager fare and drink from his cup and lie in his bosom, and it was like a daughter to him. Now there came a traveler to the rich man, and he was loath to take one of his own flock or herd to prepare for the wayfarer who had come to him. But he took the poor man's lamb and prepared that for the guest who had come to him." Then David's anger was greatly kindled against the man. He said to Nathan, "As the Lord lives, the man who has done this deserves to die. He shall restore the lamb fourfold because he did this thing and because he had no pity." Nathan said to David, "You are the man. Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, I anointed you over king over Israel, and I rescued you from the hand of Saul. I gave you your master's house and your master's wives into your bosom, and gave you the house of Israel and of Judah. And if that had been too little, I would have added as much more. Why have you despised the word of the Lord to do what is evil in his sight? You have struck down Uriah the Hittite with the sword, and have taken his wife to be your wife, and have killed him with the sword of the Ammonites. Now therefore, the sword shall never depart from your house, for you have displeased me, and you have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife. Thus says the Lord, I will raise up trouble against you from within your own house, and I will take your wives before your eyes and give them to your neighbor, and he shall lie with your wives in the sight of the very sun. For you did it secretly, but I will do this thing before Israel and before the sun." David said to Nathan, "I have sinned against the Lord." Nathan said to David, "Now the Lord has put away your sins. You shall not die." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The gospel lesson is from John, the 6th chapter. So when the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they got themselves into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the lake, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly, I tell you, you are looking for me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, for as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Then Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. You may be seated. As children, we're often told a tale of how difficult it may be for us to tell the truth to others, especially when it is a hard truth to hear. We may all at one time have heard the story of the emperor's new clothes. One day, an emperor is approached by some smooth-talking out-of-towners who want to make for him a set of new clothes made from the finest material the world has ever seen. It's so fine, in fact, that the clothes are invisible to those who are either unfit for their position or, as the story goes, unusually stupid. Day and night, the conniving weavers worked hard on an empty loom, but the emperor said nothing for fear that he would be discovered unfit for his position. When the weavers announced that their work was done, they pretended to put them on the emperor, and all who were present told him how wonderful he looked, because they too feared being found lacking if they claimed to see nothing but a naked emperor standing before them. As the emperor then processed through town in his new clothes, to the feigned oohs and ahs of the crowd, a little boy finally cried out, "But he hasn't anything on!" At which point the entire crowd erupted into laughter, finally admitting that they too saw nothing on the emperor, and the emperor, now embarrassed, recognized that he had been tricked, but continued on in naked defiance through the streets of town. The story of the emperor's new clothes is indeed a very funny story. It's one that leaves you hoping that you would never stand by and let such a thing happen to someone else, let alone let something like that happen to you. It would be even more laughable were it not all too often true, because it's very difficult to tell someone the truth, especially when it either puts us in a very tough position or puts others in a place of discomfort. I mean, isn't it best sometimes to just live and let live, to just let others go about their business, even if it's leading to their demise, and to ask that others just simply stay out of our business as well? We read in 2 Samuel today another story about a king who did indeed benefit from someone being in his business. Our scripture today picks up on a particularly climactic scene in the life and history of King David. Many of you may be familiar with the events that precipitated this exchange between Nathan and David. David, who most children know of as the little shepherd boy with a sling and a stone, the one who defeated Goliath, was now the king, charged with, how shall we say it, keeping the heart of Israel listening to the heart of God. He had all he could ever want at his fingertips. One day when he should have been off to war, David was home and saw a beautiful woman bathing on her roof. It was Bathsheba, the wife of Uriah, one of David's generals. David asked that she be brought to his palace, and they had an affair, and soon David found out that Bathsheba was pregnant. David then began to spin a terrible web of deceit in an attempt to cover over his mistake. He asked that Uriah be brought back from the war to spend time with his wife, but since Uriah was so devoted to his duty, Uriah slept outdoors on the ground instead. This left David in a bit of a bind, and so his remedy was to send Uriah off to fight at the very front of the battle, ensuring that he would not return home alive. Bathsheba then became David's wife, and from the outside looking in, all was well. But all was not well. If you're a king, it's easy to assume that you're on the right track and that you're doing just fine. It's easy to believe that you've handled your business appropriately and that you've made the best decision given the circumstances. After all, people would tell you if you were not, right? They'd never let you, for example, parade down the streets with no clothes on, or, I don't know, get away with murder. At some point, someone would intervene, right? As a society, and certainly in the South, we're not too keen on getting overly involved in other people's lives. Not directly, anyway. Now, we do enjoy, from time to time, discussing what's going on in someone else's life when they're not around. But once they walk into the room, things tend to get sort of quiet. After all, we probably shouldn't worry too much about other people's business. As Christians, though, part of the life that we are baptized into is a prophetic one. Being a prophet means being always on call to speak into the world the presence and the power of God. And it's a role that much of the time requires us to stand on behalf of God right square in the middle of other people's business. Now, we may often shy away from claiming a prophetic voice for fear that we'll end up meddling. Are you familiar with that term? Meddling? Getting into other people's business? Telling others what they should and should not be doing? Ordering their house when we should instead be focusing on our own affairs? It's a fear that's ingrained into our culture. What others do is their business. And if they want to make the wrong choices, then who am I to tell them otherwise? But what if the prophetic voice, what if our role as a prophet in this world has less to do with making sure that people hear about their wrong choices and has more to do with helping people see the possibilities that exist when different choices are made? If there's anything we can learn from Nathan's confrontation with David, it's that being a prophet has less to do with triggering someone's guilty conscience and more to do with triggering their imagination. After all, anyone with a rule book can point out faults in others. Anyone with a whistle can be a referee. But to be a prophet, to be someone who leads others to see a future that God has for them, to speak God's words into the lives of others, that takes a bit more. For our scriptures are not a book of rules as much as a story of a whole other way of living, a completely different way of seeing the world. We long to see the world as God sees it, as a place that in its brokenness is still worth redeeming, still a place of redemption and hope. To be a prophet is to learn to see others in that way, as people who in their brokenness are still capable of redemption, who in their despair are still within the grasp of hope and grace. To speak prophetically is to enter into that brokenness and darkness and flip the switch on their imagination so that they too can see that the future God has in store for them is a reality that is within their grasp. Walter Brueggemann has termed this the prophetic imagination. It does include, by necessity, the confrontation of wrongdoing, the intentional act of bringing into the light the darkness that exists. At times, our prophetic role is simply to call attention to the sin in our world, to notice it, to point it out, to make sure that it is seen in the light of day. But the prophetic imagination sends us further on that task. It asks us to not just point out wrongdoing, but to then speak truthfully about the world as God would have it, free from evil and filled with beauty, compassion, and grace. The hope is not just that evil would be exposed in our world and in our life, but that the goodness of a life lived in line with God would be seen, and it would inspire us to then get in line with that vision. How different would it be, for example, if the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. had stood on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial in 1963 and simply listed the many ways that racial injustice and inequality existed in the United States? I'm sure many gathered that day would have agreed with Dr. King, but Would they have been equipped to envision a new reality, inspired to work for change and for justice? Instead, Dr. King loudly proclaimed that he had a dream. And from that time on, a new possibility of what freedom and equality meant became real and was worth pursuing. What are the stories that have ignited your imagination and that have witnessed to a different way of living in the world? In October of 2006, a man walked into an Amish schoolroom in Pennsylvania and shot and killed 5 young girls and then himself. Within hours, the Amish community, victimized by this horrible crime, responded with words and acts of forgiveness. They cared for the gunman's widow. Many attended the gunman's funeral. They did not forget what had been done and did not find the grief to be any less over the great tragedy that had occurred in their community, but they did take quite seriously the words that they had often prayed together to forgive those who trespass against them. No one said that that would be easy, but they knew that was right. As a Christian, hearing stories like this remind us of how we might just possibly live up to the words that we pray and the words that Jesus has spoken to us, not just as guidelines or as nice gestures, but as real and often difficult, but certainly possible, alternatives to the ways of the wider culture. Where are the stories in your own life that have awakened you to the possibility of a different way of living? Where have you seen God's transforming love at work in the world? I spoke to a young man once who was answering a call to go into ordained ministry, and so he was visiting the divinity school to learn more about it. It turns out we had a mutual friend. And when I spoke to our friend later about meeting this young man, that friend's first response was, "Him? He's going into ministry?" It turns out that the middle school-aged child that he remembered was quite different from the college graduate that I had met. People change. Lives can be transformed. At some point in that man's life, someone, some church, some friend along the way, started meddling in his life and helped him to think differently about the life that he was leading and the places that God would have him go. As a prophet, Nathan was called by God to go and to meddle in David's life. But he approached David not with direct confrontation and a detailed list of David's wrongs, but rather with a story. It was a strategy born not necessarily out of fear, but out of genuine concern and love both for David and for God. What he wanted was not to trick David into pronouncing his own judgment, but rather to make certain that what David heard in the parable translated into what David felt about his actions. Nathan told David of a poor man who had a pet lamb. That man loved that lamb like a daughter. But one day, a rich man came and took that beloved lamb away from that poor man and slaughtered it and fed it to his guests. David could see that little lamb, and David could feel the pain of that poor man. David became angry at the evil the rich man had done and declared that he should be put to death for doing such a terrible thing. "But David," Nathan said to him, "you are the man." Nathan's parable caused David to wake up from his calloused self-righteousness and insulated conscience. David was acting like an emperor in his new clothes, parading around in his sin with no one willing to or able to hold up a mirror and show him that the royal immunity to which he felt entitled was an invisible thread. He was the one God had anointed to be king, chosen by God to rule over all of Israel, and look what he had done. How could he possibly expect any good to come from this? But Nathan helped David see himself and to see what he had done. And unlike the emperor who continued to parade around the streets, David repented. Psalm 51 may well have been his words at this time. It reads, "Have mercy on me, O God, for I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and sustain in me a willing spirit." You don't have to be a poet to tell stories that transform the imagination, to put a new and a right spirit in others or in yourself. By virtue of our baptism, Christians are already armed with stories that can radically witness to the goodness of God's future. As a Christian, you've heard the story of God's love and grace, a story of Christ's incarnation, life, death, and resurrection. You already know a story of a beloved lamb that was taken and slaughtered at the hands of an empire, and that conviction and transformation that comes through the reciting of that tale. In that story, the Lamb is the Son of God, Jesus Christ, whose death was not the end of the story, but rather just the beginning. For through that death came life. Through the resurrection and the glorification of that Lamb comes the end of a limited imagination and the beginning of a story that tells us that we can always be more than our past and we can always become transformed in our present. There's now always a story of hope, a story of light shining into the darkness, a story of death being defeated and of suffering, death, pain, and despair lasting only a night, because we know and we testify and we tell stories to the goodness of joy coming with each and every morning. That is our story. That is the foundation of our prophetic voice, called upon to transform both our neighbor and our neighborhoods, powerful enough to change those who hear it, and powerful enough to transform those of us who tell it. As you go through the world this week, take some time to really look around you. Where are the places or the people that are in need of a little holy meddling? And this may be a little more difficult, but where might God be doing a little holy meddling with you?
The Lord be with you.
Let us pray.
Prophetic God, you sent Nathan to speak a word of truth to David and to make the king aware of his sins. Shower all people with mercy as you did King David. Reveal your will through those who worship you today. Empower your people to speak your presence and power into the world. Make courageous any who feel belittled by those who hold greater rank, wealth, or social status. Give political leaders ear to hear your words spoken truthfully to them. Transform us. Trigger our imaginations to see the future you have in store for those who live according to your will. Make your vision ours and show your people redemption and hope in the midst of brokenness and despair. Lord, in your mercy. Sustaining Savior, you are the bread of life who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Be bread to those who hunger for your word today. Fill our lives with the leaven of your love and grow compassion and hospitality in the hearts of all people. This morning we lift up those in our local community who are hungry and who struggle for daily bread. Strengthen organizations that supply emergency food relief, as well as those which help with longer-term assistance. Protect programs that provide for the nutritional needs of children. Keep farmers and field workers in your care, and spread the rich resources of this world to those who need them most. Help all of us to see you in the face of those who hunger and thirst. And make us a people who are quick to share with those in need. Hear our prayers that we may love you with our whole being and willingly share the concerns of our neighbors. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty Lord, move through those places in our world in need of restoration. Protect the citizens of Syria, Afghanistan, and Egypt, and bring an end to violence in these countries. Send rain to drought-stricken communities and refresh parched places with a nourishing balm. Silently, we lift up to you one relationship in need of your reconciling touch. Provide healing and forgiveness in relationships that have been damaged by deceit and dishonesty. Pour on us the Spirit to think and do what is right, that we who cannot even exist without you may have the strength to live according to your will. Lord, in your mercy. God of hope, feed us with the bread of life at your table, that we may taste the freedom of eternal life and lead lives worthy of our calling through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Today's offering goes to support the chapel's emergency fund for recovery and support in communities affected by unexpected disasters. Knowing that God cares for all creation, let us share our gifts with those in need.
Today with a person or an issue that is weighing heavily on your heart, ministers will be in the memorial chapel to my right during the serving of communion, and they will be glad to pray with you. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Almighty God, good Father to us all, your face is turned towards your world. In love you gave us Jesus your Son to rescue us from sin and death. Your word goes out to call us home to the city where angels sing your praise. We gladly thank you with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven singing the hymn of your unending praise. Wonderful the work of your hands, O Lord. As a mother tenderly gathers her children, you embraced a people as your own. When they turned away and rebelled, your love remained steadfast. From your beloved people, you raised up Jesus, our Savior, born of Mary, to be the living bread, in whom all our hungers are satisfied. He offered his life for sinners, And with a love stronger than death, he opened wide his arms on the cross. As we recall the one perfect sacrifice of our redemption, make these gifts of bread and wine be for us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus, who on the night he gave himself up for us, took bread, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Blessed and broken Lord, be among your people who taste the bitter herbs of slavery and oppression. Be close to your people who are poured out in grief and despair. Remake the church, your body, where it is broken by discord and dispute, and make your whole world a Eucharist of joy and thanksgiving. Spread your table in the face of friends and enemies, that all may know your peace, and all may find in it the company of your saints, where you are all in all, in the presence and companionship of your Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, ever one God. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. The bread of God comes down from heaven and gives life to the world, gives life to you. Let us feast on the bread of life.
Thank you.
Please stand. Holy Father, who gathered us here at the table of your Son to share this meal with the whole household of your church, in that new world where you reveal the fullness of your peace, gather people of every race and language to share in the eternal banquet of Jesus Christ our Lord. And in that heavenly banquet, we give you thanks for all the ways we see signs of your grace in our lives, in laughter, friendship, and a spirit of peace. We give you thanks for the opportunities to learn on this campus and for innovation and imagination that often give our lives ease and creativity. We name with gratitude the Center for Instructional Technology for their application of technology to the practice of teaching and learning. May all of us who yearn to create find the source of our creativity in you, Blessed Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And now go out into the world attuned to sacred meddling and open your heart to the holy mischief of God, who seeks to inspire your imagination as you discover the future unfolding before you. And the blessings of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.